Access your free language gifts of the month right now. Here's what you're getting this month. First, the Making a Phone Call cheat sheet. Want to be able to talk on the phone in your target language? Then this conversation cheat sheet will help you do just that. You'll learn all the basic phrases, questions, and answers you'll need when making a call. Second, want to know the learning hacks, motivational tips, and success strategies for learning a language in 2020? Then you'll want this exclusive 52-page ebook. Download it now for free before we take it down. Third, words and phrases for the dentist. Learn how to schedule a checkup, talk about a toothache, and much more with this one-minute vocab lesson. Fourth, can you talk about your zodiac sign? Then this next one-minute lesson is for you if you want to learn. You'll learn how to say the 12 signs in your target language. Fifth, the 32 words you'll need for language learning. Noun, verb, adjective, sentence, grammar. Can you say these in your target language? If not, you'll want this quick one-minute lesson. Sixth, free audiobooks for our members only. Unlock our huge library of language learning audiobooks. Save them to your device and listen and learn. They're yours to keep forever. And finally, the deal of the month. If you want to finally master the language with lessons by real teachers and our complete language learning program, take the 12-month challenge and get 12 months of premium or premium plus at up to 45% off. So, to get your gifts and language learning resources, click the link in the description below. Download them right now before they expire.
안녕하세요, 여러분. 김소피입니다.
Hi everyone. I'm Sophie Kim.
In this lesson, you'll learn how to talk about your occupation in Korean.
This is Mark Morris, and he's on a plane to Seoul. He asks the passenger sitting next to him, Min-Yu Moon, "Are you a student?"
학생이에요.
Listen to the conversation and focus on Min-Yu Moon's response. Note, the speakers in this conversation use polite Korean. Ready?
학생이에요?
아니요. 학생이 아니에요. 투자가예요.
Once more with the English translation.
학생이에요?
Are you a student?
아니요. 학생이 아니에요. 투자가예요.
No, I'm not a student. I'm an investor.
Let's take a closer look at the conversation.
Do you remember how Mark asks, "Are you a student?" First is
학생,
student.
학생, 학생.
Next is
이에요.
Here, it's like the R in RU.
이에요, 이에요.
Note, the word you is understood from context, as Mark is asking a question. And here the question is formed by the rising intonation. Listen again.
학생이에요? 이에요.
Is from the verb
이다,
meaning to be.
이다.
Note
이에요
follows words that end in a consonant like
학생.
Altogether,
학생이에요?
Are you a student?
학생이에요?
Now, let's take a closer look at the response.
Do you remember how Min-Gyu Moon says, "No, I'm not a student. I'm an investor."
"아니요. 학생이 아니에요. 투자가예요."
First is the expression
아니요,
meaning no.
아니요, 아니요.
It answers Mark's yes or no question. Are you a student?
학생이에요?
Next, Min-Gyu says
학생이 아니에요.
I'm not a student.
학생이 아니에요.
First is
학생
student
학생
Next is
이
the subject marking particle
이
It marks student as the subject of the sentence. Note, there are two versions of the subject marking particle.
이
follows words that end in a consonant, like
학생
Next is
아니에요.
Here, not I am, but it translates as I am not.
아니에요.
Note, the word I is understood from context, as Mingyu is responding to a question.
아니에요.
Is from the verb
아니다.
Meaning to not be.
아니다.
Altogether,
학생이 아니에요.
I'm not a student.
학생이 아니에요.
Finally, Mingyu says,
투자가예요.
I'm an investor.
투자가예요.
First,
투자가.
Investor.
투자가. 투자가.
Next is,
예요.
In this case, it's like the am in I am.
예요. 예요.
Note, the word I is understood from context, as the speaker is answering a question.
예요.
Is from the verb
이다.
Meaning to be.
이다.
Note.
예요.
Follows words that end in a vowel like
투자가
Together
투자가예요
I'm an investor
투자가예요
Altogether
아니요, 학생이 아니에요. 투자가예요
No, I'm not a student. I'm an investor
아니요, 학생이 아니에요. 투자가예요.
Note, there are two forms of the subject marking particle.
이
follows words that end in a consonant, such as
학생 가
follows words that end in a vowel, such as
투자가
Note, there are two polite forms of the verb
이다
to be
이에요
follows words that end in a consonant, such as
학생 예요
follows words that end in a vowel, such as
투자가
The pattern is
아니요, occupation ending in consonant, 이 아니에요 아니요, occupation ending in vowel, 가 아니에요.
No, I'm not occupation.
Actual occupation ending in consonant, 예요. Actual occupation ending in vowel, 예요.
I'm actual occupation.
아니요, occupation ending in consonant, 이 아니에요. 아니요, occupation ending in vowel, 가 아니에요. Actual occupation ending in consonant, 예요. Actual occupation ending in vowel, 예요.
No, I'm not occupation. I'm actual occupation. Imagine you're Eugene Eom, a student. Mingyu asks you if you're a teacher.
선생님 선생님, 선생님.
Say, No, I'm not a teacher. I'm a student. Ready?
아니요, 선생님이 아니에요. 학생이에요.
No, I'm not a teacher. I'm a student.
아니요. 선생님이 아니에요. 학생이에요.
Let's look at some more examples. Listen and repeat or speak along with the native speakers.
아니요. 학생이 아니에요. 투자가예요. 아니요. 학생이 아니에요. 투자가예요.
아니요. 선생님이 아니에요. 학생이에요. 아니요. 선생님이 아니에요. 학생이에요.
아니요. 선생님이 아니에요. 엔지니어예요. 아니요. 선생님이 아니에요. 엔지니어예요.
아니요. 간호사가 아니에요. 의사예요. 아니요. 간호사가 아니에요. 의사예요.
아니요. 학생이 아니에요. 선생님이에요. 아니요. 학생이 아니에요. 선생님이에요.
아니요. 바리스타예요. 아니요. 바리스타예요.
Did you notice how the last speaker omits part of the response?
"아니요, 바리스타예요."
"No, I am a barista."
"아니요, 바리스타예요."
When directly responding to someone's question, it's often possible to omit part of the response. Here, by simply answering,
"아니요."
No. There is no need to say
학생이 아니에요.
I'm not a student. This pattern is
아니요. Actual occupation ending in consonant. 이에요. 아니요. Actual occupation ending in vowel. 이에요.
No. I'm actual occupation. You should be aware of this pattern, but for this lesson, we'll use the pattern.
아니요. Occupation ending in consonant. 이 아니에요. 아니요. Occupation ending in vowel. 가 아니에요.
No, I'm not occupation.
Actual occupation ending in consonant. 이에요. Actual occupation ending in vowel. 이에요.
I'm actual occupation. Let's review the key vocabulary.
선생님
Teacher
선생님 선생님 Engineer
Engineer
Engineer, engineer. 간호사,
nurse.
간호사, 간호사. 의사,
doctor.
의사, 의사. 바리스타.
Barista.
Barista. Barista.
Let's review. Respond to the prompts by speaking aloud. Then repeat after me, focusing on pronunciation. Ready? Do you remember how to say investor? 투자가 투자가 And how Mingyu Moon says, I am an investor. Do you remember how to say student? 학생 학생 And how Mingyu Moon says, I'm not a student. 학생이 아니에요. 학생이 아니에요. Do you remember how to say no? 아니요. 아니요. Do you remember how Mingyu Moon says, No, I'm not a student. I am an investor.
아니요, 학생이 아니에요. 투자가예요.
아니요, 학생이 아니에요. 투자가예요. Do you remember how Mark Morris asks, Are you a student? Remember, Mark uses formal Korean.
학생이에요?
학생이에요? Do you remember the word for teacher? 선생님, 선생님. And the word for engineer? 엔지니어, 엔지니어.
Let's practice. Imagine you're Mark Morris and you're an engineer. Respond to Mingyu's question. Ready?
선생님이에요?
아니요, 선생님이 아니에요. 엔지니어예요.
Listen again and repeat.
아니요, 선생님이 아니에요. 엔지니어예요. 아니요, 선생님이 아니에요. 엔지니어예요.
Let's try another. Imagine you're Eugene Aum and you're a student. Ready?
선생님이에요?
아니요. 선생님이 아니에요. 학생이에요.
Listen again and repeat.
아니요. 선생님이 아니에요. 학생이에요. 아니요. 선생님이 아니에요. 학생이에요.
Let's try one more. Imagine you're Sophie Kim and you're a teacher. Ready?
학생이에요.
아니요. 학생이 아니에요. 선생님이에요.
Listen again and repeat.
아니요, 학생이 아니에요. 선생님이에요. 아니요, 학생이 아니에요. 선생님이에요.
Now, let's take a look at some conversational phrases.
Listen to the dialogue.
직업이 무엇입니까? 저는 예술가입니다.
Listen to it again, now with the English translation.
직업이 무엇입니까?
What do you do?
저는 예술가입니다.
I'm an artist. First of all, you need to learn how to say, What do you do? That's
직업이 무엇입니까?
Listen to it again.
직업이 무엇입니까? 직업이 무엇입니까?
Now, how do you answer this question? This is the pattern you'll need.
저는
Your occupation.
입니다.
I'm a, an, your occupation. For example, I'm an artist.
저는 예술가입니다. 저는 예술가입니다.
Here are a few more professions you can use with the same pattern. Police officer.
경찰. 경찰.
Teacher.
선생님. 선생님.
Doctor.
의사. 의사.
Engineer.
엔지니어. 엔지니어.
Now, listen to some examples.
직업이 무엇입니까? 저는 선생님입니다. 직업이 무엇입니까? 저는 의사입니다. 직업이 무엇입니까? 저는 엔지니어입니다.
Okay, now it's your turn. Do you remember how to say, what do you do? Imagine you're a doctor. Do you remember how to say, doctor?
의사, 의사.
Say, I'm a doctor.
저는 의사입니다.
Now answer the question saying that you are a doctor.
직업이 무엇입니까? 저는 의사입니다.
Now, imagine you're a teacher. Do you remember how to say teacher?
선생님, 선생님.
Say, I'm a teacher.
저는 선생님입니다.
Now, answer the question saying that you are a teacher.
직업이 무엇입니까? 저는 선생님입니다.
Now, imagine you're an engineer. Do you remember how to say engineer?
엔지니어. 엔지니어.
Say, I'm an engineer.
저는 엔지니어입니다.
Now, answer the question saying that you are an engineer.
직업이 무엇입니까? 저는 엔지니어입니다.
Well done! In this lesson, you learn new occupation-related vocabulary and phrases you can use in your everyday life. You are now able to talk about your job like a native speaker. Want more Can Do series videos? Go to KoreanClass101.com to be the first to know when new videos are released. You learn practical conversations in every lesson so that by the end, you can do it. You can give a self-introduction. You can talk about where you're from. Sign up for a free lifetime account right now. It takes less than 30 seconds. Just click the link in the description to sign up and start learning in seconds.
Welcome to KoreanClass101.com. Do you know how to make a Korean sentence? If you're a fan of TWICE, you'll definitely need to know how to make today's sentence. 여러분 안녕하세요, 케이진입니다. Hi everyone, I'm 케이진. In this lesson, you'll learn how to make this Korean sentence. I want to meet TWICE in Korea. But first, if you want to speak Korean and learn in the fastest, easiest, and most fun way, go to KoreanClass101.com and sign up for your free lifetime account right now. Get our complete learning program with real lessons by real teachers. Let's start with this English sentence. I study. The word order is subject, verb. Good news! In Korean, the word order for this simple sentence is the same. For Korean word order, subject, verb. 저는 공부해요. Literally, I study. However, as the sentence gets longer, differences appear. For example, an object comes at a different position. In English, the word order is subject, verb, object. For example, I study Korean. However, in Korean, the order is subject, object, verb. For example, 저는 한국어를 공부해요. Literally, I, Korean, study. Want to add a place like I study Korean at home? Its position is not fixed, but the common pattern is subject, place, object, verb. For example, 저는 집에서 한국어를 공부해요. Literally, I, at home, Korean, study. Please note that word order in Korean is pretty flexible. But in this lesson, we are going to introduce the most common pattern so you won't get confused. Let's make a Korean sentence together at the polite standard speech level. 고 싶어요. Want to. 고 싶다 can be translated as want to in English. It is a grammatical structure which expresses desire. 고 싶어요 is a polite spoken form of 고 싶다. 고 싶어요. 고 싶어요. 고 싶어요. Here's how to use the sentence structure. Verb stem plus 고 싶어요. 만나고 싶어요. Want to meet. 만나 is a verb stem of 만나다, the Korean verb meaning to meet. 만나다. 만나다. You just need to remove 다 at the end of the infinitive form of the verb. 만나다. 만나고 싶어요. 만나고 싶어요. 만나고 싶어요. 저는 만나고 싶어요. I want to meet. 저 is a humble noun meaning I or me. 는 is a topping marking particle. Think of it as S for in English. So 저는 is like S for me. It works like a subject of the sentence here. 저는 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 All together, 저는 만나고 싶어요. I want to meet. 저는 만나고 싶어요. I want to meet. 저는 트와이스를 만나고 싶어요. I want to meet TWICE. TWICE is the name of the popular Korean girl group. 를 is an object marking particle. 트와이스를 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 All together 저는 트와이스를 만나고 싶어요. I want to meet twice. 저는 트와이스를 만나고 싶어요. I want to meet twice. 저는 한국에서 트와이스를 만나고 싶어요. I want to meet twice in Korea. 한국 is a noun meaning Korea. 에서 is a location marking particle. 한국에서 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 All together 저는 한국에서 트와이스를 만나고 싶어요. I want to meet twice in Korea. 저는 한국에서 트와이스를 만나고 싶어요. I want to meet twice in Korea. Let's make a Korean sentence at a casual speech level. 고 싶어 want to 고 싶다 can be translated as want to in English. It is a grammatical structure which expresses desire. 고 싶어 is a casual spoken form of 고 싶다. 고 싶어 고 싶어 고 싶어 Here's how to use the structure. Verb stem plus 고 싶어 만나고 싶어 want to meet 만나 is a verb stem of 만나다 the Korean verb meaning to meet 만나다 만나다 You just need to remove 다 at the end of the infinitive form of the verb 만나다 만나고 싶어 만나고 싶어 만나고 싶어 나는 만나고 싶어 I want to meet 나 means I or me 는 is a topic marking particle Think of it as for in English So 나는 is like as for me It works like a subject of the sentence here 나는 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 All together, 나는 만나고 싶어. I want to meet. 나는 만나고 싶어. I want to meet. 나는 트와이스를 만나고 싶어. I want to meet twice. Twice is the name of a popular Korean girl group. 를 is an object marking particle. 트와이스를 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 All together 나는 트와이스를 만나고 싶어 I want to meet twice 나는 트와이스를 만나고 싶어 I want to meet twice 나는 한국에서 트와이스를 만나고 싶어 I want to meet twice in Korea 한국 is a noun meaning Korea. 에서 is a location marking particle. 한국에서 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 All together 나는 한국에서 트와이스를 만나고 싶어. I want to meet twice in Korea. 나는 한국에서 트와이스를 만나고 싶어. I want to meet twice in Korea. Now, let's make a Korean sentence at a formal speech level. 고 싶습니다. Want to. 고 싶다 can be translated as want to in English. It is a grammatical structure which expresses desire. 고 싶습니다 is a formal form of 고 싶다. 고 싶습니다. 고 싶습니다. 고 싶습니다. Here's how to use the structure. Verb stem plus 고 싶습니다. 만나고 싶습니다. Want to meet. 만나 is a verb stem of 만나다. The Korean verb meaning to meet. 만나다, 만나다. You just need to remove 다 at the end of the infinitive form of the verb. 만나다, 만나고 싶습니다. 만나고 싶습니다. 만나고 싶습니다. 만나고 싶습니다. 저는 만나고 싶습니다. I want to meet. 저 is a humble noun meaning I or me. 는 is a topic marking particle. Think of it as for in English. So 저는 is like as for me. It works like a subject of the sentence here. 저는, 저는, 저는. All together, 저는 만나고 싶습니다. I want to meet. 저는 만나고 싶습니다. I want to meet. 저는 트와이스를 만나고 싶습니다. I want to meet twice. Twice is the name of a popular Korean girl group. 를 is an object marking particle. 트와이스를, 트와이스를, 트와이스를. All together, 저는 트와이스를 만나고 싶습니다. I want to meet twice. 저는 트와이스를 만나고 싶습니다. I want to meet twice. 저는 한국에서 트와이스를 만나고 싶습니다. I want to meet twice in Korea. 한국 is a noun meaning Korea. 에서 is a location marking particle. 한국에서, 한국에서, 한국에서. All together, 저는 한국에서 트와이스를 만나고 싶습니다. I want to meet twice in Korea. 저는 한국에서 트와이스를 만나고 싶습니다. I want to meet twice in Korea. Let's review. Repeat after me, focusing on pronunciation. Ready? Let's start with a polite standard speech level. Do you remember how to say want to meet? 만나고 싶어요. 만나고 싶어요. How about I want to meet? 저는 만나고 싶어요. 저는 만나고 싶어요. Now try I want to meet twice. 저는 트와이스를 만나고 싶어요. 저는 트와이스를 만나고 싶어요. Now, let's put everything together. Say, I want to meet twice in Korea. 저는 한국에서 트와이스를 만나고 싶어요. 저는 한국에서 트와이스를 만나고 싶어요. Now, let's try the casual speech level. Want to meet. 만나고 싶어. 만나고 싶어. I want to meet. 나는 만나고 싶어. 나는 만나고 싶어. I want to meet twice. 나는 트와이스를 만나고 싶어. 나는 트와이스를 만나고 싶어. I want to meet twice in Korea. 나는 한국에서 트와이스를 만나고 싶어. 나는 한국에서 트와이스를 만나고 싶어. Let's try the formal speech level. Want to meet. 만나고 싶습니다. 만나고 싶습니다. I want to meet. 저는 만나고 싶습니다. 저는 만나고 싶습니다. I want to meet twice. 저는 트와이스를 만나고 싶습니다. 저는 트와이스를 만나고 싶습니다. I want to meet twice in Korea. 저는 한국에서 트와이스를 만나고 싶습니다. 저는 한국에서 트와이스를 만나고 싶습니다. This is the end of this lesson. Question or comment? Let us know. See you next time. 다음에 또 봐요.
Most people don't like to hear this, but consistent hard work is one of the biggest factors in your language learning success. The course or method you choose makes a difference too. But at the end of the day, you ride or die by the work you put in. The quantity of time spent studying language doesn't necessarily determine the quality of your study. Spending 3 hours a day watching movies doesn't help you learn much if you're not actively engaging with the language. In this video, we'll talk about 3 ways to actively engage your mind while studying a new language. Number one, think of your brain as a muscle. You're probably familiar with the phrase, feel the burn, or maybe no pain, no gain. If you've been to your local gym recently, there's a chance you might have heard one of these phrases or seen them plastered on a wall. There's an idea in the world of sports and workouts that the discomfort you feel when running, pumping iron, or doing some other physical activity is what brings results. During a healthy workout, the muscles of the body are affected at a microscopic level. The discomfort you feel is your muscles being pushed to their limit. It's the limit pushing that strengthens your muscles so that over time, your performance increases. In the context of language learning, it's helpful to think of your brain as a muscle. Just as we need to push our physical limits when exercising, we also need to push our mental limits when learning a foreign language. Have you ever studied or practiced your target language in a way that left you tired or even exhausted? If so, you've experienced what it's like to push your brain out of its linguistic comfort zone. Number two, practice active listening. One of the easiest ways to push your language skills is to practice active listening. Active listening is when you listen to someone speaking your target language and you do your best to understand what you hear. The best way to accomplish this is by using audio that you can't completely understand on the first listen. Preferably, you want to use audio that has subtitles or transcripts for you to double-check your understanding after you listen to it. You can use movies, YouTube clips, or even our language program, which has very useful transcripts for each lesson. During a practice session, you should listen to the audio several times. The first time around, it's okay if little to no words stick out to you. Simply make a mental note of any words or sounds you recognize. The second time you listen, you're likely to recognize a little more than you did the previous time. Expect similar results with your third or even fourth time listening. After you've hit the ceiling of words you can decipher, go ahead and look at the language subtitles or transcripts. Listen to the audio again, reading along with the text. Odds are that you will see words in the text you know, but didn't hear correctly. You're also likely to encounter words that are new to you completely. As you play back the audio and read along, try to guess what these words mean from the context of the words around them. After you've read along a couple times, feel free to look up the remaining unfamiliar words in a dictionary or translator app. This active listening exercise routine is a great way to increase your listening and comprehension skills while picking up some new vocabulary along the way. It also allows you to learn new words in context, which itself is a powerful method to help you retain what you study. Number three, practicing with native speakers. Practicing with native speakers is the epitome of pushing your language skills. Using what you know to communicate in real time is where the rubber really meets the road. Try to connect with a native speaker on a weekly basis. Regularity is what makes the difference when you're learning a foreign language. If you live in a large metropolitan area, then there's a significant chance that there are some local native speakers nearby. Try hitting up a local language exchange or meetup group to make the necessary connections. If you're unable to find a practice partner locally, then you can take your search online. There are a number of sites out there that help you find and connect with other language learners from around the world. There are tons of language learners around the world who have learned or are learning a second language. You're likely to find someone who knows your target language and is looking to improve their own language skills as well. Learning a new language isn't always easy, but it's the discomfort that comes with pushing your ability in the language that produces results in your studies. Don't be afraid to step outside of your comfort zone. The further away you get from your native language, the closer you'll be to attaining fluency. Also remember that language learning is in every way a lot like an adventure. There will be fun times and times when it feels like you're swimming up the proverbial stream. It's by keeping your head up long enough through these ups and downs that you will experience the priceless satisfaction that comes from learning a foreign language. Just keep moving forward. Let's be honest, it's difficult to learn a new language. If you're new to a language, it's going to take consistent and concentrated effort to start using the language fluently. However, this fact shouldn't discourage you. While learning a new language is hard, it's far from impossible. In this video, we'll outline 5 tips you can use to jumpstart your language learning. Follow these pointers to learn your target language in a way that is efficient and effective. Number 1. Limit your native language use when practicing. The idea here is that when you practice with native speakers, you do your best to refrain from using your native language. This is generally harder the less you know, but if you can manage to stick to this rule, you'll reap some huge rewards. If you commit to a no-native language practice session, it's not going to be easy. Most likely, there will be some frustrating, if not painstakingly difficult moments where you either have trouble understanding the person you're talking to, or you can't say what you want to say. It's precisely in these moments that your language learning muscles are built up to capacity. The process really isn't all that different from working out in the gym. Just replace the physical burn of lifting weights for the mental burn of thinking in a new language. In the end, if there's no pain, there's no gain. Obviously, this no native language rule doesn't have to be written in stone. There are times when it's more beneficial to break out of the target language box and have something explained to you in your native language. However, this should definitely be the exception rather than the standard. Number 2. Have set times to practice speaking throughout the week. Now that we've discussed a good way to practice speaking, let's delve a bit into when to speak. One of the best commitments you can keep while learning a new language is to set aside specific times to practice speaking the language on a weekly basis. Ideally, these speaking sessions are on set days at specific times and form part of your weekly routine. If you don't make it a point to set aside specific practice times, you run the risk of your language practice falling through the cracks of your busy schedule. I recommend writing down your practice times and hanging it somewhere you can always see it. You could also input the times into your phone and set an alarm. The point is to remind yourself of your commitment every day so that it doesn't fall by the wayside. Number 3, get picky about vocabulary. Whether you practice with a podcast, a friend at a coffee shop, or a teacher, you're going to run into a flood of new and unfamiliar vocabulary. Despite your best efforts, it's unlikely that you'll be able to pin down every new word or phrase you hear and study it later. Thus, you should pick and choose which new words you focus on. The defining quality of each new word you learn should be its practicality. The more useful a word or phrase is to you in a conversation, the more important it is that you learn it. Don't feel like you have to cram the entirety of your target language into 1 week of study. Take it one step at a time. A few practical words here, some more there. Before you know it, you'll see your vocabulary improve. Number 4, write and practice short monologues. This tip can be a lot of fun. Begin by selecting a topic you enjoy discussing. Then, simply write out a short monologue or speech on the subject in your target language. The first thing you'll notice while doing this will likely be the holes in your grammar and vocabulary. But when you try to write out your thoughts in a foreign language, you might inevitably hit roadblocks. You might not be able to think of a word or know how to formulate a specific idea or opinion yet. This can be great because these holes are the exact areas where you should focus your studies. You can bring up these problem areas in your next lesson or browse through your favorite language course or textbook in order to find the answer. The constant process of finding these language holes and filling them is what keeps you moving along the path to fluency. Once you finish your short text, it's a great idea to practice reciting it or even memorizing it. The memorization will help you internalize the new grammar and vocabulary you've learned. Reciting it will get your tongue and mouth used to the sounds. Number 5, keep an up-to-date list on what you want to learn. Throughout your studies, you should always have a sort of language shopping list. As you practice and study, you will most likely come across things you'd like to be able to say, but don't know how to yet, especially if you follow our previous tip. Write this wish list down. It's one thing to learn the vocabulary you pick up via a course or podcast, both of which are great. It's a bit different when your vocabulary gets personal. Learn the words that matter to you, either because they're practical or because you simply find them interesting. The more relevant the vocabulary, the more likely you are to retain it. Some people might tell you it's impossible to learn a new language for whatever reason, but it's important to remember that the way you study and engage with a language greatly affects how quickly or effectively you learn it. Being able to speak freely with native speakers is an amazing ability in itself, but being able to speak freely to a whole new group of people opens you up to possible new relationships. Most people don't realize that spending the time to build relationships in a foreign language can actually help you improve your language skills dramatically. In this video, we look at how making relationships in a foreign language can help you learn the language faster. The benefits of having friends and partners who speak a foreign language. First, it's motivational. One of the greatest struggles for anyone learning a second language is motivation. 9 times out of 10, learners start out their language learning journey with loads of enthusiasm, only to see it gradually wane over time. Try as they may, it's difficult to maintain the spark they once shared with their new language. So why not borrow energy from a different part of your life? When you make relationships with people in your target language, all the excitement of a new relationship carries directly over into your learning. Suddenly, you have a very rewarding reason to improve your skills and keep practicing. As your partner or your friends get involved, you will also have the advantage of a constant source of support and encouragement. Second, it makes language learning practical. Studying vocabulary and grammar is a vital part of language learning, whether you use a podcast, textbook, app, or find yourself in a classroom. However, as great as studying is, a language really only starts to come alive once you start using it in everyday life. There's a huge difference between a scripted conversation in a lesson plan and a real-life conversation with a native speaker. Building relationships with native speakers will give you the chance to talk in your target language often. Furthermore, it will be in a way that feels natural. You'll learn the words in the context, which is hugely important. Third, it's fun. One of the greatest benefits is that it allows you to practice without having it feel like practice. Oftentimes, you'll find yourself so wrapped up in the conversation that you forget you're using a foreign language. This takes a lot of the pressure off and helps you focus on communication over trying to speak absolutely perfectly. You also get to learn about a whole new culture from your partner or friends, so you're not only learning language skills, but also about the cultures that surround your target language. The risks of having friends and partners who speak a foreign language. First, it's easy to miscommunicate. When it comes to relationships, humans can easily misunderstand each other. So it can be hard when building relationships in your target language when you or your partner's lack of ability in each other's respective native tongue can lead to miscommunications that would otherwise be avoidable. Depending on the language you're speaking, a simple mistranslation or mispronounced word can drastically change the meaning of a sentence. As long as you can afford each other some extra patience and the benefit of the doubt, then you should be able to overcome this pitfall. Second, your language skills could suffer if your relationships don't work out. If all your language practice is wrapped up in one person and your relationship with that person doesn't work out, then your language learning could take a big hit. So it's best not to put all your hopes for language growth on one area, relationship or otherwise. You don't want to risk losing motivation, so try to find it in many different areas. An idea for building relationships in a foreign language. Make games out of getting to know one another. Sometimes, opening up in any new friendship or partnership can be hard. Add in the added struggle of a new language, and it can feel impossible to share your true feelings with others. So instead of trying to take first interactions so seriously and talking about the usual things like the weather or work, try to ask new, interesting questions. Try to figure out what the other person's hobbies are without asking directly, or what kind of job they have. This will give you a chance to stretch your language skills in a new way, and you'll probably get some funny answers out of it too. Being comfortable being silly or making language mistakes is a great way to bond with someone, even if you've just met. Relationships in a foreign language have a lot more benefits to offer than drawbacks. Don't be scared to open up to people and make mistakes. Hey everyone, welcome to The Monthly Review, the monthly show on language learning. How to finally learn language in 2020, your New Year's resolution solution. Today, you're going to learn 1, 3 reasons most goals fail, 2, the three rules for successful goal setting, and three, we're going to set you up with your first language goal for 2020. So, if you've failed with your goals or New Year's resolutions before, then this lesson is for you. You'll be able to finally learn your target language, make measurable progress, and reach every goal you set. But first, listen up. Here are this month's new lessons and resources. First, the Making a Phone Call cheat sheet. Want to be able to talk on the phone in your target language? Then this conversation cheat sheet will help you do just that. You'll learn all the basic phrases, questions, and answers you'll need when making a phone call. Second, want to know the learning hacks, motivational tips, and success strategies for learning a language in 2020? Then you'll want this exclusive 52-page ebook. Download it now for free before we take it down. Third, words and phrases for the dentist. Learn how to schedule a checkup, talk about a toothache, and much more with this one-minute vocab lesson. Fourth, can you talk about your zodiac sign? If not, then this next one-minute lesson is for you. You'll learn how to say the 12 signs in your target language. Fifth, the 32 words you need for language learning. Noun, verb, adjective, sentence, grammar. Can you say these in your target language? If not, you'll want this quick one-minute lesson. To get your free resources, click the link in the description below right now. They're yours to keep forever. Okay, let's jump into today's topic. How to finally learn language in 2020, your New Year's resolution solution. So, January is over, but let me ask you a question. Have you set a resolution for this year? If you haven't, it's understandable. Most people end up failing with their resolutions. You set one, you try to do it in January, and by February, there's no progress. Doing it is no longer fun, or you get sidelined by something else. So you quit and put it off until next year, or whenever the guilt of quitting your goals comes back to haunt you. So, what's the problem with setting resolutions? Why do we keep failing? First of all, regardless of what most people say about New Year's resolutions, setting goals, whether on January 1st or any other time of the year, is a good thing. You have to know where you're going and what you want to achieve. Otherwise, you'll be floating around aimlessly from one language app to another and have nothing to show for your time spent. But the problem lies with the goals that people set. For example, most people set goals like, I want to master Chinese, or I want to lose weight, or I want to be fluent in Japanese. And based on these kinds of goals, here are three reasons why 90% of New Year's resolutions fail. First, resolutions fail because they are not specific and not measurable. Take a goal like, I want to master Chinese this year. The problem is that's a very vague goal. What do you mean by master? Do you want to speak about the economy, or do you just want to have everyday conversations? And can you really measure how much progress you need to master the language? The second reason is they are unrealistic. You might think, but isn't it good to set huge goals and aim for the stars? It's not bad, but if you say, I want to be fluent by September, is that realistic for you? Are you ready to commit yourself to nothing but language learning, 6 to 8 hours a day, nonstop? The answer is no for most people. The third one is there's no action plan. The problem is, you'll still fail even with a specific and realistic goal if you don't know when and how you're going to do it. For example, when will you study? How long will you study every day? And how will you study? So now you know why most people fail with their New Year's resolutions. Then how do we set New Year's resolutions and actually succeed? Here are the three rules for successful goal setting. Remember, your goals must be 1. Specific and measurable, 2. Realistic, and 3. They must have an action plan. Yes, the complete opposite of everything you heard earlier. For example, let's say you're learning Italian this year. Instead of saying, my goal is to learn Italian this year, set a specific, measurable, realistic goal for the month, like speak 3 minutes of conversation by February 28th. And you can also set a yearly goal, like 30 minutes of conversation, and work towards that. The whole point is, 3 minutes is measurable. You set a timer, time yourself, and know when you reach it. It's realistic. Instead of saying, I want to learn the whole language, you're just aiming for 3 minutes for the month, and maybe 30 minutes for the year. So ask yourself, do I have time to learn enough of the language to speak for 3 minutes? That will vary from learner to learner, but 3 minutes sounds much more realistic than I want to master a language. Finally, you still need an action plan for your goal. And for that, you need to answer these questions. When will you study? How long will you study every day? Where do you plan to study? How will you study? What is your study schedule? This is the most important part because this tells you when and how to study. If you don't answer these questions, you'll have no idea what to do and you'll quit because you have no routine to stick to. So for example, when will you study? I'll study at 9 p.m. on weekdays. How long will you study every day? I'll study for 20 minutes. Where do you plan to study? I'll study at home, in the living room, on my computer. How will you study? I'll listen to one audio lesson a day for 5 days. What is your study schedule? From Monday to Friday with audio lessons. I'll listen to the lesson, then go through the lesson notes for 20 minutes each day. Here are a few more things you can do to improve your chances of success. Reward yourself after hitting a goal. Studies have shown that giving yourself a reward after reaching a goal is crucial to creating lasting habits and continuing to conquer more goals. Write down your small, measurable goal and put it somewhere you'll see it often. Now that you know why New Year's resolutions fail and you know what to do differently, it's time to set your goal. So thank you for watching this episode of Monthly Review. See you next time. Bye. Great work. Here's a reward. Speed up your language learning with our PDF lessons. Get all of our best PDF cheat sheets and ebooks for free. Just click the link in the description.